At the beginning of April, we checked in with the artificial intelligence called Polly to find out how morale was faring across the land during this pandemic. Erin Kelly is the CEO of Advanced Symbolics Inc., Polly's keeper, so to speak, and she joins us now from the nation's capital to find out how morale is a month further into our COVID existence. Erin, how are you managing there in Ottawa?
Doing well. Thanks, Steve.
Good to hear. You know, we always do this off the top because there's some people who don't understand how you do what you do with artificial intelligence polling and so on. So give us the Advanced Symbolics one-on-one on how you do what you do.
Sure. Polly uses the same methodology that we use in university level research, which is to say she gets a representative sample of the different populations whose opinion she is measuring. And that gives us the same accuracy that you would get in traditional market research, except we're using it with social media, which means we get much larger sample sizes and we get the data much faster.
Okay. When you were last here a month ago, you told us at that time that based on your tracking, morale was surprisingly strong and good from coast to coast to coast. Here we are a month later. What are you finding now?
Well, now a month later, we're still finding it's high, but we did have dips. So we saw that the lowest dip in morale happened the week of April 21st. And at first we didn't know what had caused that because we were looking at COVID related issues. And then it dawned on us that was actually 2 days after the shooting in Nova Scotia. And even though we are tracking how people feel about COVID in the quarantine, and we did see that people's feelings about quarantine and about the virus themselves were negative, we do think that was influenced by the shooting in Nova Scotia. The population, and that happened across the country, not just in Nova Scotia, right through to British Columbia. We are finding this week that morale is back up. Still low in Quebec and other parts of Canada. It's lower in Quebec. It's still quite good in Quebec. But it's coming up now since premiers are talking about opening the economy again.
Any reason why it might be lower in Quebec than in other places?
Well, in Quebec, two things we think. Number one, it's a dichotomy, right? So on the one hand, Quebec has been the hardest hit. So it has always been about 10% lower than Ontario in terms of morale. We're also seeing in Quebec, there's quite a split now that Quebec is looking to open its economy. On the one hand, we're seeing people are saying, I'm happy that the economy is opening. I'm happy that things are getting back to normal. We're also seeing that fear is going up. So as if you're Premier Legault, it's very difficult to navigate this because people are as equally looking forward to opening of the economy as they are fearing it. There's a lot of fear about children going back to school, for example, but also people are glad that they're going back to school on the one hand as well. So I think people are don't know how to feel. And so there's a lot of uncertainty there.
Understood. Tell me this, Erin, I can remember almost 20 years ago when 9/11 happened, it was basically wall-to-wall blanket coverage of that one story for months. And then at a certain point, news organizations, I guess, dared to introduce other stories into the mix as well. We've got basically the same situation now. It's all COVID all the time on every all news channel, pretty much with us as well, with a few exceptions here and there. Can you tell whether people are saturated with this story yet?
They are saturated. We're definitely seeing people say, I'm tired of the death counts. And I think that's why we really saw it dip after Nova Scotia, because that was more death. People are tired of that story. It's not so much that they're tired of COVID necessarily, but I think people want to hear, they don't just want to hear daily death counts. They want to hear, what do we need to see to get things back to normal? Is it possible? You know, is it possible? How does the phased approach look? You know, how can we get this back? People want to hear about testing. They want to hear other stories, and they do want to hear about things other than COVID as well. But if we are going to keep talking about COVID, we need to change the mix a little bit and talk about food. People are really concerned still about supply chain and grocery stores. They're not hearing enough information about that. They're concerned about school issues and how they can keep. We're particularly seeing among parents of young children, they feel their kids are falling behind. What kind of tips and tricks can they have? So they're looking for different types of content. People are definitely saturated with the daily sickness and infection count.
Okay, good to know. Note to self, as we say, that's very good for for those of us who are in this business to know that. Tell me this, I have, if I've seen it once, I've seen it 100 times on social media, people saying things like, you know, I never voted for Doug Ford last time, and I'm not even sure I would next time, but I got to hand it to the guy. He's really showing some leadership chops during this whole thing. Now, that's all anecdotal. Have you got anything empirical which shows Doug Ford's popularity numbers are actually up?
Yes. So we see actually, I would call it more of a change in Doug Ford's popularity. So interestingly, we are seeing among his traditional supporters, there's more criticism of Doug Ford than there had been in the previous year. Criticism about how long it's taking to open up the economy. Mr. Ford's base would have expected him to be the first one to be out there looking at a plan to reopen the economy. On the other hand, we are seeing people who didn't like Doug Ford in the past saying, kudos to him. We really like how he's handling it. He's showing sensitivity. He's showing common sense. And they are surprised by that. So in the end, I don't think this will be lasting in either way. I think his base will come back. I think he has an opportunity actually to leverage how he has done during this crisis. I mean, a lot of people comparing him to Donald Trump, where they expected him to behave like Donald Trump, and he has not. He's really surprised people. So I think he's got a lot of opportunity and goodwill to build on. And I think his base is just slightly critical. But I think once things get moving again, we don't think that's going to last.
No, the premier's risen to the occasion. There's a little question about that, whereas the American president really has been quite disgraceful from time to time. But tell me this. I mean, one thing that did surprise me the other day, I guess it was last weekend, you know, there were those people protesting on the South Lawn at Queen's Park, basically saying, we want to get back to work and come on, let's reopen this economy. And when the premier found out about it, he called them all a bunch of yahoos. Now, that's probably his base on that lawn. What did your tracking, what did Polly have to say in terms of tracking opinion on that?
Well, I would say the premier was on side with the majority of the population. We see that continuously COVID denial has been decreasing. So in March, when the lockdown first started, people were more in denial that this was a serious threat and that it was worthy of shutting down the economy. Now people are much more on side that it was the right decision. There's not a lot of COVID denial, but you're right, where there is COVID denial, it is in Mr. Ford's base. And so that's why we're seeing more criticism of him in that base, but it's not like they're going elsewhere. They're not going to suddenly become NDP supporters or liberals. So I don't see this continuing. I think once the economy gets on track, and it really is, they are not on side with the majority of public opinion in Ontario.
Okay, you mentioned the economy.
Or anywhere in Canada.
Or anywhere. You mentioned the economy there, so let me pick up on that. Last time you were here, you did say, I think, that financial issues, you know, jobs, economic security, that kind of thing, were still top of mind and top of the list of things that people were very, very concerned about. Now, since then, we've had almost an announcement every day about some aspect of government support in order to help with the economic ravages of this time. Has that reduced the public's anxiety that you've been able to find?
It has helped with their morale. Anxiety is still high. So in Ontario, we're seeing almost 60% of people in Ontario are worried about finances. That's second only to Alberta. Alberta is the highest in the country for obvious reasons. Ontario is second. And we're seeing it in particular among parents of school-aged children. These folks, even if they are allowed to work from home, they're having difficulty working from home. A lot of them are saying they're using up their vacation time to stay at home during the virus, during the quarantine. So it's very high levels of anxiety among people in Ontario. Less so in Quebec, where they have benefits that are paid for by the state. When you lose your job, you get benefits that kick in. Don't think we have that in Ontario. So there's definitely concern about finances and also leaking into healthcare in cases where people have lost their benefits.
Which demographic or group or gender or age group, whatever. I mean, you tell me the way you track it, but who's stressed out the most right now?
By far, parents with young children. They are stressed out, not just about their health and their finances, but their children's education. A lot of them expressing that they don't have time to get on conference calls, teach the kids, especially parents with young children the children are still just learning to read, so they can't go off and teach themselves. We're seeing a lot of anxiety about parents, single parents who have to take their children out in public. They don't have a choice. They have to take their kids to the grocery store, and they're saying there's no supports there. A lot of them saying they have seniors hour and they have volunteers going out and getting groceries for seniors, but nobody there to support children. And the problem with young children is you can tell a child, don't touch your face, don't touch things in the store. But I mean, a five-year-old doesn't grasp that. So they have no choice but to bring them. They're being socially, they're being criticized for doing so. A lot of them are saying that people make comments to them in the grocery store because they brought children. They're not supposed to, but they don't have a choice. They can't leave their kids alone at home. So we're definitely seeing parents of young children are three times more stressed than any other demographic, including seniors. A lot of people have acknowledged that seniors are more hard hit by the virus, but the seniors who are living independently, at least, seem to be doing better than parents with young children.
Huh, fascinating. I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that I think I'm a bit more of a sports fan than you are. But having said that, I don't know, I find I'm watching all these old baseball games and hockey games on TV in the evenings while I'm getting ready to for the next day's shoots. Have you been tracking sports leagues to see, I don't know, like what we miss the most or who's handling this pandemic the best or anything like that?
Yes. Yeah. So we're looking at a number of industries because, you know, some industries have been shuttered because of the quarantine. Sports is an obvious one. People don't really want to watch reruns of sports. So
I do.
Who's doing
I'll watch that. I'll watch that. If it's that or nothing, I'll watch that.
We're definitely different. I like to watch playoffs. I'm a playoffs person. So we're definitely seeing that some leagues are doing a much better job than others at keeping people engaged, and more ordinary people, again, than the fanatics. But the NHL, not just because we're hockey fanatics in Canada, but the NHL is doing a lot. They've got their players out there working in food banks. They're doing community work. They're putting videos out on TikTok. The big surprise for us, so the two that are doing the best are hockey and baseball. They're popular sports, but wrestling is doing really well. Now, they've made some controversial decisions, but it got people who have never watched wrestling before take an interest in wrestling. And that's always the interesting part when you get people that weren't watching your sport before and they're joining it. The big sufferers in this has been the basketball, the NBA. They had, like the Raptors had a great momentum coming into this with their win, and we're seeing that interest in basketball has fallen about 30% because they're not engaged. They don't see them on TikTok. They don't see them engaging in other ways. So we definitely see there's opportunity here for companies. They need to really think, even if you can't keep your organization open, how do you continue to stay top of mind? And the way to do it is not to send out email saying we're taking care of our employees and stuff like, because everybody's getting bombarded with that. You really need to start getting much more creative and to engage your base so that when the economy does come back, you still got them.
Got it. I got about 30 seconds left here. And let me ask you one last thing. Number one, can you track for next time you come on how popular the notion is of the Canadian Football League getting $150 million subsidy from the federal government? I'd love to know whether people are essentially on side with that or not. And the other thing is, like, what are you going to be tracking over the next, let's say, month or so that you haven't been yet?
Well, we're going to be tracking a number of different industries. Hey, you know what? If you want to do a poll of your audience and ask them what they'd like us to track, I'd love to hear that, because we can track whatever people think is of interest to them. We've been, as staff, we've been doing what our customers have asked us to track and what people who correspond with us ask us to track. I'd love to see what people who watch The Agenda would like us to track. And if we can, we will bring that to the next show.
Erin Kelly, you are on. I'm going to hit Twitter right after this is over. I'll mention it on the podcast later today, and we'll get some of those suggestions for you. You stay safe there in Ottawa, okay? And we'll talk to you again soon.
Thanks. Same to you, Steve.
Erin Kelly from Advanced Symbolics Inc.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario. CPA Ontario is a regulator, an educator, a thought leader, and an advocate. We protect the public. We advance our profession. We guide our CPAs. We are CPA Ontario. And by viewers like you. Thank you.